Hello, I'm Radhika Fox, CEO of the U.S. Water Alliance, and on behalf of the Value of Water campaign, thank you for joining us for this special event. Today is our annual Day of Advocacy, Imagine a Day Without Water, and we have an incredible lineup of leaders joining us for today's discussion. This is our sixth annual Imagine a Day Without Water, and we started this day to make sure that no one in this country takes this essential service for granted. We love the diversity of people who participate in this day and all the creative things that you do. We hope you're sharing your great work online through the hashtag ValueWater so we can see what you're up to. This year, Imagine a Day Without Water is taking on a new urgency. We have the competing catastrophes of COVID-19, an economic recession, and a climate crisis. First, we're going to listen to a series of discussions between leaders in three regions of America who face distinct water issues: California, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and Buffalo, New York. And to kick us off, we're going to hear from California. I'm pleased to welcome a good friend, Rick Callender, who was recently named the CEO of Valley Water in Silicon Valley, as well as Wade Crowfoot, California Secretary for Natural Resources. They're going to share with us some of the unique water challenges we're facing here in my home state of California. Rick and Wade, thanks for joining us, and over to you.
So, Wade, it's good to see you. Glad we had the opportunity to sit down together and talk about the future of water in the West and California as part of the sixth annual Imagine a Day Without Water. Wanted to start with asking you a question, however. Wanted to start by asking, what comes to mind when you hear that today is Imagine a Day Without Water?
Well, Rick, great to be with you. And in answer to the question, I think, you know, we're out West, obviously, in California. So water scarcity comes to mind. We suffered through the largest drought in California's history just a few years ago, where some rural communities literally ran out of water. Their wells ran dry. But I think beyond water scarcity, of course, it's, you know, imagine a day without clean and safe drinking water, which is a challenge across the country. So I think this is a great opportunity to take a moment to realize just obviously the role that water plays in our lives, our communities, our economy, and to redouble our efforts to make sure everybody actually has access to this vital resource. And Rick, I wanted to congratulate you for becoming general manager of Valley Water, which is one of the largest water agencies in California, provides water to a large portion of our San Francisco Bay Area, including Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. Let me turn the question back to you. What do you think as it relates to water scarcity, a day without water, and what are you doing to create more water reliability within Valley Water?
Indeed. Well, that's scarcity is exactly why we're investing in rebuilding some of our dams, like Anderson Dam, which is our largest reservoir, but needs rebuilding because it's seismically unsafe. And, you know, what we've also done is, as you know, with the state's $485 million that you've invested in our Pacheco project with us, we're looking at building a new Pacheco reservoir. And it's exactly why Measure S and Valley Water has put Measure S on this ballot to try to fund local clean, safe water projects and natural flood protection projects. So these are the exact kind of projects that are excellent for our economy. So if you look at what they had was the Value of Water campaign and the American Society of Civil Engineers report, they had the report called the Economic Benefits of Investing in Water Infrastructure. What that report found that is investing in water infrastructure leads to more efficient business and manufacturing, leads to higher profits, more jobs, higher wages. So if we fully invest in and look at our water infrastructure needs of the next 20 years, it's going to create $4.5 trillion in GDP and lead to hundreds of thousands of new jobs. Looking at our Measure S alone, that creates 40,000 full-time jobs for Silicon Valley if that measure is passed. You know, water is truthfully critical for the economy. So, you know, we're proud that California is really taking a lead on policies and investments to ensure a sustainable and equitable water future. I'm going to turn it back to you as well. Can you share what you and Governor Newsom are doing at the state level to make that happen? And what are you particularly proud of?
Yeah, I'm happy to talk about California and what we're doing. But let me just say that I think it's so valuable the work that you and so many others that are participating here today are doing, making the case for water infrastructure investment at the federal level and across the country. You're absolutely right. Investment and reinvestment in our water infrastructure across the country is not only critical to community well-being, but economic growth and prosperity. And so I know we in California really want to do whatever we can to support this national effort to actually get more federal investment in water infrastructure. I have to say, in California, over the last year and a half since our governor, Gavin Newsom, has taken office, very proud of the fact that we passed a Clean and Safe Drinking Water Act to address this challenge we have in California, where many communities in our state, which is the fifth largest economy in the world, if you can believe it, don't have reliable access to clean and safe drinking water. Many of these are rurally isolated communities. Some of these are urban communities. And this challenge obviously is one we face in California, but I know other water agencies across the country face. And so as a result of passing this, this Clean and Safe Drinking Water Act, we actually identified funding and policy to ensure that very as quickly as possible, we're actually helping these communities move on to reliable sources of safe water. So that's a big deal. I'll also say, like so many other states, we are taking a portfolio approach to building water reliability across our state. We issued this, what we call this water resilience portfolio, which identifies what state government needs to do to support local and regional water agencies. And I think this is really transferable to most states. We in California run a water system of systems. And so state and federal governments, from my perspective, need to do all they can to support a regionalized approach to providing water and frankly, building resilience of those water systems. I'm also interested in this evolving conversation about racial justice and equity. Indeed. And Rick, I want to commend you. As I understand it, one of the first things you did when you became general manager is pass a racial equity policy for Valley Water. And I want to ask you a little bit more about sort of what was the origin of that policy and what does it actually do as it relates to, you know, your providing water in your part of California?
Well, thank you for the question. I think coming from an administration that's shown really progressive stances on racial equity, you know, the governor doesn't just talk the talk, the governor walks the walk. You know, I've seen him at a lot of our state NAACP events, and I've commended him for it. And so I definitely want to take this opportunity to commend him for his leadership. And as you know, I've been a leader in the NAACP, both statewide and nationally, and been involved in the civil rights movement for a long time. So my actions are truly guided by equity and equality. You know, all people internally, externally of Valley Water deserve to have equal opportunities to participate. Participate in the water and the environmental system. Systematic racism is real. Many people who look just like me have been left out of the environment, the water, environmental justice conversation. You know, Valley Water is 100 years old. I'm the first African-American CEO. Yes, that's a milestone, but I'm still the first African-American CEO. So if what I say is, if you're paying our taxes, if you are drinking our water, if you're living in our county, you should have equal access to jobs, to contracts, to services. You should have equal access to having your voice be heard. You know, in the past, and to somewhat extent, now, many people, when they think of the word environmentalism or they think about water, they often think of saving the wells, hugging trees, etc. But when folks think about climate change, what comes to mind is melting ice caps, suffering polar bears. And historically, American society has failed to make the connection that in terms of the impacts on environmental injustice, including climate change, our lives, our families, our communities, all of us who depend on the physical environment and its bounty are people of color. Racial equity, diversity, and inclusion is about, let's just make sure everybody's at the table. We're not gonna leave anybody behind. So what this is about is this is ensuring that everybody is welcome as part of the water discussion. So last question. You know, as we hold this conversation, it's less than 2 weeks away before a national election. What's your message to national candidates on what you need to address in terms of the community's water challenges?
Well, I think we need to be clear-eyed about the water challenges that we face. You so eloquently put the challenge of racial equity and justice. We have to recognize that our water systems have delivered resources unequally to Americans. So one, you know, I'd say to candidates that we, you know, they need to recognize and lead efforts to redress that. Two is we need to be guided by science. We spent a lot of time in California, particularly this summer, given the wildfires, talking about the impacts of climate change. And we need federal policy and state policy, local policy driven by science. Science has guided the water sector to be able to provide clean and safe drinking water, as well as wastewater to a vast majority of Americans. We need to use that same commitment to science to understand how a climate how a changing climate is impacting our water systems. And then most importantly, I think this is probably something that a lot of people already recognize, but I'd say to people, you know, do your civic duty, recognize the amazing privilege we have in this country to exercise our democracy by voting. It's not something that happens everywhere in the world. And I think we're already seeing this, that a lot of people are redoubling their commitment to actually participating in this election, regardless of what priorities you have or what candidates you support. Be part of this democracy. Not only will our country be better for it, but frankly, our water sector will be better with a vibrant democracy and proactive representatives who we support in office. So Rick, I wanna thank you for all that you do. I wanna thank this broad network of groups that we have out across the country participating in Imagine a Day Without Water. And there's a lot of work to get done. So I would just say onward to our work all together.
Indeed, onward and upward. Wade, I've really enjoyed the conversation. Couldn't agree with your last, the answer to the last question more. Hey, thanks for sitting down with me today.
Yeah, best of luck today.
Thank you.
Rick and Wade, thank you so much for joining us and sharing what you're seeing and what you're doing to ensure that California and water-stressed regions like it have the resources that they need to continue to thrive. Now, I'm excited to pivot to our next regional spotlight, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, where we'll talk about the opposite but no less important type of water stress, too much water. As we imagine a day without water, we need to focus on how having too much water can be just as devastating as having too little. We've seen so many regions exposed to the risks posed by flooding, precipitation events, inundation from rising seas on all of America's coasts. From the Gulf Coast regions like Houston and New Orleans to inland areas like Nashville to Columbia, South Carolina, so many communities are facing heartbreak of these costly natural disasters. So I'm pleased to be joined by three incredible leaders from Milwaukee who are talking about how they're managing for this challenge of too much water. We'll hear from Mayor Tom Barrett, who has led the city of Milwaukee since 2004, and he will be joined by Kevin Schaefer, General Manager of the Milwaukee Regional Sewerage District, the city's Stormwater and Wastewater Management Agency, and Karen Detmer, the Superintendent of Milwaukee Water Works, the city's drinking water utility. Mayor Barrett, Karen, Kevin, thank you so much for joining us today.
Mr. Mayor, Karen, you know, one of the bad things about the pandemic is some of the people that we get to work with so closely, we get to hardly see anymore. So it's so nice to see your faces and to have this discussion about really an important issue, which is the U.S. Water Alliance's sixth annual Imagine a Day Without Water. It's a time for us to really think about areas that have too little water and some areas that have too much. So it's something that we are visiting. It's the sixth year in a row. And Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to start with you and ask you what your thoughts are about imagining a day with either too much water or not enough water.
Well, Kevin, again, it's nice to see you, and it's good to be with Karen as well in this virtual world. And I love the fact that the city of Milwaukee lies on the shore of Lake Michigan, and I affectionately refer to us as America's fresh coast because we are blessed to have the Great Lakes on our shore, because we know how important it has been to the culture of the city, to the history of the city, to the economy of the city, the recreation of the city, the education of the city. This city has been built alongside the lake with the rivers flowing into it. So it is an important part of our community. It's who we are as a community, and we recognize that.
It is. We really are so fortunate to be where we're at and have the Great Lakes to both recreate in and to utilize. And Karen, for you, it's, you know, And for those that don't know, I'm the wastewater utility. Karen is the drinking water utility here in the city of Milwaukee. And Karen, what's your picture of water stress? What is it that you think about when you think about a stress on the water systems here in the region?
Well, Kevin, too much water can present issues for the water quality that enters our rivers in Lake Michigan, as you're well aware, as the general manager of the, or executive director of the sewerage district. Stormwater and agricultural runoff, but also what people flush down the toilets to, or pour into the sewers, increases the need to treat the water before it returns to Lake Michigan. But we cannot take for granted the great resource we have. We have an abundance of water and we need to protect it, or we will threaten our ability to use it. The better we protect Lake Michigan now and truly understand that this is our drinking water source, the less we need to invest to treat water to reach the high quality standards that enters our homes and businesses. In turn, we'll have more capital to put toward corrosion control treatment, education and replacement of lead service lines, as well as investment in our infrastructure and still keep our essential drinking water service affordable.
Karen, it's so true. I mean, we face so many different water challenges, and you and I are very fortunate to work for a committed leader like the mayor. Mayor Barrett and I have been doing this for 16 or so years.
A long time.
Yeah. And it's just been such a great thrill to work with a committed leader like that, who has done so much for the city and for the region and for the state when it comes to water issues. So, Mayor, would you like to talk about some of your achievements that you're most proud of in the water world?
Well, I think it's important that it's not just government. In fact, government just plays a role, because the history of Milwaukee is we really are a hub of innovation and investment in water technology and infrastructure, and an area rich in water resources, which is important for our well-being. So we've got many, many industries that are committed to water. If you think about brewing, for example, that's an innovator in water technology. And one of the things that we recognize is that Milwaukee was able to grow up with all these great breweries, a lot of machine companies that used water in their technology, but also other government entities. And Kevin, as you know, is the leader of MMSD, and Karen is the leader of our waterworks. We've had a long-standing commitment to investing in water infrastructure to keep our systems safe and reliable, because we know it's a precious resource. But we've gone a step further as well. And this happened when I first became mayor. We had a group of citizens who came to us and said, we want Milwaukee to be a leader in sustainability, and we want you to work with us so that we can have other cities look at the progress we're making. And I said, great idea, run with it. And that was the creation of our Milwaukee Green Team, which led to establishing our Office of Environmental Collaboration, which has been the point for a number of important programs. It's our Milwaukee Energy Efficiency Program for homeowners and commercial building owners that allow us to invest and make homes and businesses more energy efficient. Our Milwaukee Shines program, which allows, again, homeowners to benefit from increasing solar installations. The Milwaukee Energy and Environment Program, ME3, for improving sustainability of small businesses. And then Homegrown, which is a special program in a lot of the central city parts of the city, where we're able to take old lots, foreclosed homes, and make them pocket parks or make them gardens. And so what we tried to do is to take the whole sustainability concept and extend it throughout our city government. But clearly one of the leaders, and Kevin can blow his own horn on this, is the work that MMSD has done, I think, from a sustainability standpoint as well, with the water retention in keeping the pressure off our deep tunnel system, so that a lot of the water that we see falling from the sky can be retained at its natural spot. And I think that's an important step as well. So we're very, very proud. And again, you've got with me two of the leaders in our community on this, in making sure that we're taking a really system-wide approach in making this a place that people can look to where there is water. And again, we're blessed to have the water, but we know that there comes a strong responsibility along with that.
Well, Mr. Mayor, I'm not much of a musician to blow my own horn, but I will say that the MMSD has done a phenomenal job. We have really been focusing on how to keep water out of the sewer system, like you talked about, out of our deep tunnel system. Our deep tunnels were installed in 1993, and we've really cut CSOs, combined sewer overflows, down to an afterthought. They occur maybe once or twice a year, but we still have them, and so we still need to do more. But I'm most proud of some of the flood management work that we are doing and we have done, where we've not only addressed the 1% probability storm with our floods, but we've also brought back recreational components to those waterways so that people can utilize them more. We brought back habitat. We've really tried to make the waterways, the veins of the region that really help keep us healthy and keep us moving forward. We've just had a wonderful effort moving upstream, and working with your green team to expand green infrastructure here in the region has been one of the highlights of my career as well. And as we're doing that, we're starting to see that there's not just improvements in keeping water out of the system, but we're making the lives of our constituents so much better. And as we're doing that, we're becoming more resilient to climate change, and we're being adaptable. And one of the most recent highlights for us is we just were certified for climate bonds at the district. So when we issue municipal bonds now, they are climate bonds. It's a pretty rigorous set of milestones that you have to pass to be a climate bond certified. So we're extremely proud of that. But I know there's a lot going on, Karen, on your side of the infrastructure divide. And let's hear more about what WaterWorks is doing.
Sure. So, we regularly collaborate with our academic partners and the Water Research Foundation to develop best practices and advanced technologies, as you mentioned. Currently, we're working on a corrosion control treatment study that will inform best practices nationwide in ensuring that corrosion control treatment for municipalities that have lead service lines and water utilities that have lead service lines are following the best practices to ensure that their water source is being protected when it comes out to their customers at the tap. We're using a pipe loop study for that study. And we're collaborating with the UWM School of Freshwater Sciences to not just look at the corrosion control treatment and those water quality parameters, but also to expand our knowledge of biofilms within the water service lines. So we're looking at those opportunities to ensure that we're informing the best practices moving forward. And of course, interagency collaboration with MMSD and others helps us understand the interconnectivity of the water we use to our environment and leverage that collective knowledge. Speaking of collaboration, MMSD and Milwaukee Water Works hopes to be a leader in water technology and is expanding to become a leader in water equity through our work with the US Water Alliance. We're looking at developing an equitable approach to ensuring that we have the next generation of water workforce that looks and is part of our community.
Well, and the mayor talked about it. It's really a synergy trying to bring all the people together. And it's a water synergy that we're seeing here in Milwaukee. We're very fortunate to have the universities, to have great utilities. We also have the Water Council here, which is a group of technologies, of companies developing technologies around the water space. So it's just a really great environment to be in if you're looking to advance clean water for the region. Mr. Mayor, one last question. There's only 2 weeks left till the election. What advice do you have for us?
Oh, there's an election coming up? I guess I've noticed it. I've seen it on TV. Well, I think what you're looking at, the hurricanes that are battering parts of our country in the southeast and the east, or if you look at the forest fires, or the fires that you were seeing ravaging California, or the challenges that you see in places like the Chesapeake Bay or the Everglades or the Great Lakes or the Mississippi River area, we know that climate change is real. And we know that we have to have leaders in this country who, first of all, are not in denial and that recognize that we have to face these problems that we have, not only as problems, but as challenges. What can we do better? How can we, for our generation and more importantly for future generations, make sure that we're good stewards of our earth? So my message is pretty simple. You got to get involved. And I hope everybody who's listening to this gets involved and votes on November 3rd or before.
Karen Detmer, Mayor Tom Barrett, it's so nice to see you. And thank you for taking the time for this discussion today.
Thank you very much, Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin. It's been a pleasure.
Kevin, Karen, and Mayor Barrett, thank you so much for your leadership and for setting an example on how communities can tackle a climate crisis and our water equity crisis together and ensure that no resident has to imagine a day without or with too much water. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our third and final regional spotlight, Buffalo, New York. Here, we're looking to the third type of water stress, water quality and safety. Too many Americans fear or face that the water that comes out of their tap, that they drink or cook with and use in restaurants or breweries is unsafe. From industrial cities in the Northeast and Midwest to rural agricultural regions in California's Central Valley, ensuring that our water quality is safe is such a huge issue. To paint a picture for us of what this water stress looks like and to share incredible examples of how to rebuild aging infrastructure, I'm delighted to introduce Mayor Byron Brown, who has led the city of Buffalo since 2005, and OJ McFoy, General Manager of the Buffalo Sewer Authority. OJ and Mayor Brown, over to you.
Mayor, when you think about imagine a day without water, what comes to mind?
You know, it's hard to imagine a day without water. I think about getting up and taking a shower in the morning, brushing your teeth in the morning, my wife's morning cup of coffee that she has, perhaps washing the dishes in the morning. All of the things that we rely on water for, our firefighters, if there's a fire, they need water to put out that fire. Many of our business operations require water. So it is really hard to think about the hardships that would be created to live a day without water.
So Mayor, as you know, since 2006, we have invested as a city over $350 million in improving our water infrastructure, from everything from waterline replacements to treatment facility upgrades to smart sewers to green infrastructure. You know, that has been your huge commitment to our city and making sure that the assets that we have that are buried underground and sometimes out of sight are continuing to make sure that we keep this city safe. Can you think of some of the other things that you have going on that we have done in this time frame that you were most proud of?
Well, first of all, OJ, let me say it's been great working with you as General Manager of the Buffalo Sewer Authority. Before you, David Comerford, who was General Manager of the Sewer Authority. We've had a real commitment in the city of Buffalo to protecting our water, to delivering clean, pristine, affordable water to our residents. It's part of our focus on diversity, equity, inclusion, making sure that all of our residents are able to access clean and affordable water. One of the things that we've tried to do is help people who have breaks in their water lines, who have old lead lines. We created a roll program, the Repair Old Lead Lines program, and we have invested in repairing those lines to protect members of our community from the effects of lead poisoning. Seeing other communities across the country where children have been poisoned by lead in water, we wanted to make sure that didn't happen here. So ROLL, Replace Old Lead Lines, was one of the programs that we initiated among a large variety of things that we do, including our treatment of water, how we treat water to protect our children and the general public in the city of Buffalo.
Yeah, excellent. Mayor, you mentioned our Replace Old Lead Lines program. Now, in 2016, you established some of the lowest rates in the nation with 5 parts per billion, 3 times lower than the EPA's limits for lead poisoning. So you know, at that time, what were you really thinking? I know you mentioned, you know, we really want to protect our environment, but lowering it that level, you really, you know, you look at the amount of expenditures that's going to come at with that. But how important is it for you to just ensure that we have all of our citizens as safe as they possibly can be?
We were looking at the horror stories that we were seeing in other cities across the country, where their water was polluted, where lead had leached into the water. People in cities across the country, including Buffalo, were concerned. Could this happen to us? Could this happen in our community? And we wanted to assure people in Buffalo that their water was safe, that their water was reliable, and that we were going above and beyond the EPA requirements of 15 parts per billion to a standard of 5 parts per billion, which is actually the Food and Drug Administration standard for bottled water. That was quite a message that we wanted to send. We worked on that together. It was not easy to do because certainly it did increase some costs. But it also gave people in our community a sense of comfort that they could trust our water, that our water was safe, making us one of the few communities in this nation that had that kind of water standard.
Mayor, that's excellent. One of the words you just mentioned there was trust. One of the things in the utility industry, you know, when we look at a day like imagine a day without water, is the communities being able to trust that they are going to have safe, high quality, affordable water. Some of the things that you've done this year, you know, as we're in the midst of this pandemic and we are spaced, you know, far enough apart from each other not to be having our masks on, some of the things that you've really focused in on this time has been making sure that we're taking care of those who are at least fortunate. So I know in July you started our water amnesty program. Could you discuss that a little bit?
Yes. And I'm glad you mentioned that we both started this conversation with masks on. We took them off because we're properly spaced a little further than 6 feet apart so that we can have this conversation without wearing a mask. We started the water amnesty program to protect, to support low-income residents of our community. Residents of our community who perhaps were laid off or who lost their jobs because of COVID-19 and its impact on the economy so that they could keep their water on, so that they could defer their payment of their water bill. Critical program, we've been able to help hundreds of people through the water amnesty program, one of the first cities in the nation again to do this. Yes, there has been some financial hit to the bottom line of our water system, but we thought it was more important to protect our residents and to make sure that during COVID-19, our residents had access to water and sanitation to keep themselves safe. We also, during this period of time, established a water turn-on program. One of the things that utilities do, whatever kind of utility it is, for non-payment of the bill, whether it's your water bill, your gas bill, your electric bill, your cable bill, the service gets turned off for non-payment. Well, we decided during COVID-19 we had to go the exact opposite way, and for people whose service had been turned off, water service had been turned off for non-payment, in fact, some people who might have had their service turned off years ago, we actually proactively went out and got the service of those individuals working with them, doing leak detection first, we turn that service on, and we're able to help another more than 200 people in our community in that way by reconnecting their water service.
Absolutely. And you mentioned being proactive, Mayor. I know as we close on this segment, I really and truly appreciate your time. But one of the things we talked about in being proactive is all of the efforts that we have involving our affordability of water. You mentioned our amnesty program, that's one of them. Also our programs that help with our seniors. If there's something else that you wanted to tell the people on this day, imagine a day without water, what would that be?
Every resident deserves access to clean water. Water is a right, it's not a privilege. We believe that every resident of the city of Buffalo should have clean water, reliable water, safe water. That's why we initiated a number of the programs that we've discussed today and many more. Our water pathways to affordability program to look at different income levels, to look at the needs of senior citizens, to look at the needs of low-income people, and to try to help them ensure that they can afford to pay their water bill. So that was another important program. So again, as we think about during this time of COVID-19 and social unrest, people protesting for racial equity, people facing economic hardship, we've tried to do everything that we can to keep our water affordable, to keep our water clean, pristine, safe in the city of Buffalo, and to make sure that the water is on in every household in our community. It's part of our commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion.
Mayor, I appreciate you working with you today. I appreciate you giving us this time. Today is Imagine a Day Without Water. It is vitally important that everyone has access to clean, safe, and affordable water. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, OJ.
Mayor Brown and OJ, thank you so much for sharing the work that you're doing in Buffalo. I'm delighted to turn to our final segment of today's event, where we'll be tying together all the things that we've already discussed through the lens of water equity and the ways in which the most vulnerable among us experience water stress in their communities and in their daily lives. We call today Imagine a Day Without Water, but too many Americans don't have to imagine it. It's real, and they are living it now. I'm so excited to moderate this panel of national leaders, all who have a unique and powerful story to tell that is at the intersection of water, equity, and environmental justice. First, we'll hear from Angela Blackwell, who is the founder and residence of PolicyLink. Angela is a lawyer, an advocate, and an activist working on systemic racial and economic equity in a broad set of issues from health and housing to infrastructure, to arts and culture. Catherine Flowers will also be joining us, and she's the founder and director of the Center for Rural Enterprise and Environmental Justice. And it was just announced that Catherine is a MacArthur Genius Fellow. She's joining us from her home in rural Alabama, where she's a teacher, a civil rights leader, and a tireless advocate for rural communities who face challenges around poor sanitation and contaminated drinking water. And we're also joined by Stephen Rowe Lewis, the governor of the Gila River Indian Community, a reservation in Arizona lying on the banks of the Gila River, one of the largest tributaries to the Colorado River. For him, water is not just a critical and scarce resource, but the backdrop to the community's identity and culture. Angela, Catherine, and Governor Lewis, thank you so much for joining us today. I wanted to start by asking each of you to share what comes to your mind when you hear the phrase, imagine a day without water. Angela, may we start with you?
Absolutely, Radhika, and it's so good to be with you. When I hear the phrase, what I think about is that most people imagine a developing country. They imagine someplace far away What I want is for people to know that there are 2 million plus people right here who don't have access to clean drinking water. I want people to know that the same racial inequalities that we have been fixated on as a nation and as a world, really, in terms of how COVID is hitting, the same people are the ones who you can predict that they're not going to have access to the water that they need. What you'll find is that people who are Black, people who are brown, people who are indigenous are the ones who always are being left behind and are being left behind in this regard too. And I want people to know that poverty is a predictor for all of this. Those who live near and in poverty are the ones who you can predict are going to have a challenge. When I hear people thinking about what does it mean to have a day without water, imagine it. I want them to imagine a fully inclusive society in which everybody has access.
Thank you so much, Angela. And Catherine, what do you think of when you hear the phrase, imagine a day without water?
Well, first of all, I grew up in Lowndes County, Alabama, which is between Selma and Montgomery. I actually live in Montgomery now. And I remember times not having water. I've been in positions where the water was turned off. But also I've been in positions where we didn't have access to sanitation. And I grew up living in a place where initially we had an outhouse where we had to go outside to use the bathroom. And inside, when we couldn't go outside, there was something that we used and took it outside later. There are people today that are actually living without access to sanitation in many rural communities across the United States, and particularly in Lowndes County, Alabama. More recently, we lost someone on July 3rd who died from COVID, who was living in a situation where she did not have access to sanitation and was straight piping and had raw sewage outside of her home. And we found that in Lowndes County, Alabama in particular, which is located between Selma and Montgomery and has a illustrious history in terms of voting rights, that Lowndes County became, for the state of Alabama, the per capita had the highest death rate from COVID and also the highest infection rate from COVID. And we're not surprised that this has happened. So when I imagine access or the lack of access to water, I just imagine how hard it is to just have a basic standard of living in one of the wealthiest countries in the world, and how it's just a representative of the inequality that exists that we have to change.
Catherine, it's hard to imagine that anyone should live in such conditions. Governor Lewis, what do you think of when you hear the phrase, imagine a day without water?
Well, first of all, I'm just honored to be here with my esteemed panelists here, these two strong women. Water protectors, water fighters for equality, especially now. I grew up with strong women, and my family descended from strong women, and female leadership is most important and critical at this time. And I want to also just to commend them for just all of what they've done in regards to equity for water and clean water. And Ms. Catherine Flowers, you know, just for your genius MacArthur Foundation Award, that is amazing. And again, congratulations. What immediately comes to mind is my people's history, the Gila River Indian community. We trace our origins to the ancient Hoogum culture that irrigated and farmed what's now central and southern Arizona thousands of years ago. European contact was first made with us beginning in the 1600s and is well documented that we were highly skilled farmers and agriculturalists that created a self-sufficient agricultural system and civilization for our people. And after gold was discovered in California in the mid-1800s, the community at that time had a thriving farming economy through trade with other people, other Native American nations, and also those new groups passing through Arizona on their way to California. But the fortunes of my people changed soon after the end of the Civil War, when non-Indian settlers began moving into the area upstream of the Gila River and almost immediately began illegally diverting the community's water source, an outright theft. The United States failed to stop such theft of this water, of our water, what we call our shuduk, which led to the decline of our agricultural production to subsistence, barely subsistence levels, eventually resulted in widespread starvation and devastation of our political economy. There was a headline in a Chicago newspaper from the 1900s that referred to Pima Indians starving because of lack of water. So I don't have to imagine a day without water. That history is terribly real for us. And what kind of, and what comes to mind in regards to a day without water is the many generations of my ancestors who had to live and survive without the water that was rightfully theirs. Unfortunately, we were able to successfully fight for our water rights. What we call the Gila River, we call that our Cudiacama, the old man river that sustained us. And there was a settlement, a historic settlement that was reached in 2004 that my late father, Rod Lewis, one of the first Native attorneys, fought and dedicated his whole life for. But every member of my community knows this history and the impact of not having water. And so I would also, again, just in closing, point out that the community, the community's exception is not the rule when coming to addressing these past wrongs related to the taking of tribal water. There are many other stories about tribal communities in this country that don't have to imagine a day without access to clean water. They're living with the reality today during, and especially during this pandemic.
So Catherine, congratulations on your recent award as a MacArthur Genius Fellow. For those of you, those of us who have been working with you for a while, we've always known you were a genius. For the decades long work that you've been doing around climate justice and environmental justice in rural communities all across America. You talked just a little while ago about the conditions in Loudoun County. Can you now talk about some of the policy work, the advocacy you've been doing to address these issues?
Well, yes. The policy, first of all, thank you for the acknowledgement. The policy work that I've been doing has been basically teaching politicians and policymakers about the conditions, and oftentimes people attempt to make policy without even understanding the conditions. It's hard for a person coming from an urban, a very urban perspective who've never been to a rural community to even make the kind of policy that can impact these communities. For an example, oftentimes when I read policy, a lot of it is written, even and is well-intentioned, written to get funds to towns and townships. A lot of these areas are not even incorporated. So it excludes them from being able to have access to funding that may help with infrastructure. And I believe that if you are an American citizen living in the United States of America, whether you live in an incorporated or an unincorporated area, you should still have access to infrastructure and have access to funds to support that when the community is unable to afford it. So we have been bringing people actually to Lowndes County so they can see it firsthand and they can actually go and talk to the people that are impacted by this and go into their homes. And as they describe what they deal with, I think that people leave there with an impression that helps them to be able to go back and use their skills to construct policy to address it. For an example, we invited Senator Sanders, Bernie Sanders, to come to Lowndes County. And because of his trip to Lowndes County and meeting Pamela Rush, the woman who passed away July 3rd, he ended up appointing me to serve on a committee, a task force that helped to make policy as it relates to climate change and environmental justice. I've also had an opportunity to testify before Congress. I've had an opportunity to invite the UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty to take it to an international level where we use human rights as a framework to address this issue as well. So those are the numerous ways in which we've been working to impact policy change and working with various partners, you know, to collaborate and bring about what needs to happen, and showing people that this is a problem across the U.S. This is not, you know, I don't want people to think you go and put in a few septic systems in Lowndes County, Alabama, and the problem is solved, and have a press conference and say it's over. It's not over. It's a problem throughout the United States, and we have to find a way, along with policies, in order to address it for everyone that's impacted.
So, Angela, I have had the good fortune of getting to work for you for a dozen years, and there are so many things that I have learned over those years, including this idea of the curb cut effect. Can you talk about what that means and how you think it relates to this moment as we're weathering the COVID-19 pandemic?
One of the things that we have to see as an asset is how important it would be for all of us if we got it right for those who are most marginalized, targeted, discriminated against, vulnerable. We talked in the beginning about how it's Black and Brown and Indigenous and poor people who are most likely to be directly impacted by the inhumanity of a culture that does not view water as a human right. One of the things that I have long been learning with so many people across the country and across the world is that there is much to learn from what we see in our communities across this country from the advocacy of people with disabilities in wheelchairs. Those curb cuts that are there in the sidewalk are there because people with disabilities who were gaining rights realized that those rights were meaningless if they could not get around the communities where they had the right to education, the right to jobs, the right to public accommodations. And so those cutouts in the sidewalk are there because of the advocacy of people in wheelchairs. But how many times have we all had the opportunity to benefit from them? Whether you're pushing a stroller and didn't have to pick that contraption up, whether you're a worker pulling carts, pushing wagons, and your work was made easier. It even saves lives because 9 out of 10 unencumbered adults cross the street at the corner because of the orientation of the curb cut. Well, what that shows us is that when we solve problems for those who are most targeted, marginalized, burdened in society, with nuance and specificity, we solve them for everybody. And once you know what you're looking for, you can see it every place. I'll just give you one other example, not smoking in public places. That has saved millions of lives. It started because of the advocacy of flight attendants who were stuck in those airplanes, unable to get away from people smoking. It didn't matter if you had a no smoking section, it didn't protect them. When they joined with Ralph Nader and they were able to get smoking banned on airplanes, that began the flood of a movement to ban smoking in public places. Again, think of the millions of lives that have been saved. We can apply that to everything, to our economy, to transportation, to employment. It really comes to bear right now where COVID is hitting people who are the most discriminated against, targeted, marginalized. But because it is hitting them so hard, we are learning several things. One, that the health of the nation will not thrive if we don't focus on the health of those who are impacted most. That the economy is dependent on people who are frontline workers. If they can't go to work, America cannot go to work. And that the racism that we are now focusing on as a result of people witnessing the murder of George Floyd, everybody at home because of COVID, seeing it over and over again, the nation finally seems to have come to a position where they've said it stops here. And once it stops and this racism gets knocked out once and for all, the economy and everything else will benefit. Well, California has done something I am so proud of. Governor Newsom put together a task force, Business and Job Recovery. And this task force has really been looking at many things, but one of them is how to do the recovery in a way that is safe. And like every other state, we've been on a bit of a roller coaster, opening up when things look good, and then having to pull back once there was a problem. And what they've started is they've developed an equity metrics that requires the counties to be able to show that they are disproportionately using their resources, their testing, their contact tracing, their push to get people to engage in protective activities, that is being done in the areas that are hardest hit. What that will mean is that counties will not be able to open up unless they can show their focus where they have their biggest equity problem. And if they do show it, they can get on a speedier track to opening up. That's a classic example of using equity to make sure that all can benefit from the best that we know.
Thank you so much, Angela. I do have to say, Angela has a wonderful podcast called Radical Imagination. I really encourage everyone to listen to it. It's absolutely wonderful. So when I think about the work that all three of you are doing, the idea of partnerships and really partnerships across scale seem to underlie it. You know, Catherine, I feel like you are one day working with your next door neighbor, the next day working with a national organization like the U.S. Water Alliance, the next day with a member of Congress. Governor Lewis, what I know of the work that you have done on the Colorado River Basin is not only made sure to that your tribe had a full seat at the table, but have also fostered amazing partnerships all across the basin around drought contingency planning. And Angela, everything that PolicyLink does is about partnerships, including the Water Equity Climate Caucus that you convene with frontline organizations. So could all of you talk a little bit about how you think about partnerships and your work to advance water equity in this country?
I'll start and go quickly. One of the things that we have been doing is we have, you're right, Radhika, we can't do anything without partnership. If you have a big goal and a North Star, then you know you can't do it by yourself. And the water issue is right there. And one of the things that we have launched with the Gulf Coast Center on Law and Policy is the Water Equity Climate Resilience Caucus. And what the caucus has been able to do is to really pull together the power and the voice of the front lines, the frontline workers, the frontline communities, and have their wisdom drive the policy agenda, have their might push that policy agenda forward in their communities, but also at the federal level, and make sure that we are measuring that impact so that the very people who need this most are the ones who benefit. So seeing that focus and seeing that power come together is really what we've been able to demonstrate, working together with those who know most about what needs to happen.
And this is Catherine. I'll just piggyback on, you know, on what Angela has said, and I think that is very important to have partnerships. I had the opportunity to go to Standing Rock. And when I was in Standing Rock, I met a lot of people that became lifelong friends because it was important to understand and make the connection that the battle that was going on there impacted all of us, even the work that I was doing in Alabama around water. We have to, I think, look at the parallels and the values that we all hold dear in terms of all of our ancestors and what they have brought to this point in terms of how we protect Mother Earth and how do we make sure. And one of the things, Governor, that I came away from Standing Rock with was the seven generation principle, which I have made it a part of my work and my life, because when I think about partnerships and what we're trying to bring about, I think about my grandson and I think about him and the seven generations to come. Because if we use that as our guiding principle, then of course we don't look for short-term solutions. We look for things that are far more sustainable. Because what I don't want to see is my grandson having to fight the battle. I like to be able to provide a bridge so he can take it a step further than where I've taken it. The type of partnerships that we've had thus far have been, of course, with our Indigenous brothers and sisters in terms of helping people to understand the connections and the similarities in our culture and in our value systems as it relates to water and as it relates to the natural environment. We've also been working with people like Earth Justice. I recently joined the board of NRDC. I'm working with the Columbia University's Human Rights Institute, the Climate Reality Project. Anybody that would work with us, where we share common values, we're willing to work with them to further our capacity because we can't do it alone. And a lot of the communities that I work with, what I'm very, because I'm from the country, I'm a country girl. And my dad, when we were kids, he would take us around all of our cousins' homes to say, these are your relatives, so we can know who our relatives were. And I kind of use that same principle when I organize and I go into communities and I sit on the porch, you know, in our community, we talk about mom and them. I'll sit on the porch with mom and them or Miss Shug or whomever, because they're the experts. They're the ones that are living in the communities. I wouldn't know what I know about wastewater and about raw sewage running back into people's home if I wasn't listening to people that are living in those communities. And consequently, that has driven the type of partnerships and collaborations that we've had. And more recently, I've been working with people on the technical side of it in terms of trying to imagine a wastewater treatment system or a toilet that you can flush and clean water comes out of it. But the paradigm that we want to use in designing that is not just having engineers who's never lived in these communities, never experienced these problems, try to design a solution that they can't even imagine, but to have the Miss Shugs and the mom and them sitting at the table and being part of that paradigm as we try to design these solutions. And I think that that's the best way that we can kind of show and demonstrate and model what partnership and true partnerships with the communities look like, encompassing the principles of environmental justice and also the seventh generation principle.
And then Governor Lewis, do you want to respond to the question?
Yes. No, I really, you know, just want to build off of, you know, both of my fellow panelists, just great comments. Stacey Abrams, she came out to the Gila River Indian community earlier this year before the pandemic. And we took her out to a place called the Mar 5. And that was an area that my father saw at the beginning. He didn't see it at its when we completed it. It's a working aquifer that we're storing water and recharging water and also bringing back the original flow of the Gila River and bringing back the traditional indigenous wetlands along the banks of the Gila River. And it's also an education site as well, where we're teaching our young people. We're teaching outsiders who come in about our historic tie to the river and showing our water management principles of storing water, keeping our aquifers strong, and also providing to our elders and to our community members ways where they can still go and they can still find those traditional plants that we make our baskets out of, find those traditional clays that are part of the silt underneath the flow of the river. And we brought Stacey Abrams out there. She came again with talking about voting rights, especially in this one of the most important critical elections in our lifetime, and the undercounting, voting, voter protection of those marginalized populations, of those populations of color, those issues that are coming up and that are playing themselves out right now, and also the census and the undercounting, historic undercounting of also our communities of color as well. And we took her out there to the Mar 5, and she, I didn't know in her prior life, she was an environmental technician as an attorney and worked, in the environmental sciences. And so she saw the connections from Georgia to the Sonoran Desert in Arizona, the connections of water justice and environmental racism, those terrible effects that have on a people. And when we find out that we are connected, when we work towards those connections and maintaining those connections with other organizations, other groups, other communities, there's a strength in those connections. And those connections are what we use to build partnerships with and what we can use to bring disparate groups together to make change, to change policy, to influence policy, before, especially with negotiating the drought contingency plan and those Colorado River management guidelines, tribes, Native American tribes, did not have a seat at the table. The Gila River Indian community did not have a seat at the table, but we leveraged those important partnerships to make sure that we had a seat at the table during those drought contingency plannings. So it's important, and especially for tribes, we brought tribes together. We brought other stakeholders together during this time. And I wanna say that for those underserved groups, they have to be involved early on, especially tribal nations. We have to be involved early on in those water management discussions. And again, the DCP, how that whole process, how that played out and was finally approved, is a good example of fighting for your right at the table and making sure in the future, because we're already discussing the new Colorado River management guidelines that need to be replaced and revisited by 2026. And so we're relying again on those partnerships based on hard work and maintaining those connections so that we continue to have a seat at the table, finding those allies, finding those values that align, and making sure, you know, that we bring as many people along as possible in these discussions, making sure that we are involved, especially those underserved communities.
As we hold this conversation, we are less than 2 weeks away from a major national election. What is your call to action about how all candidates can ensure a safe and affordable water future?
I like to turn the question around. I think that instead of calling on the candidates, I think I need to call on the voters. And I'm encouraging the voters to vote, and take 10 people with you.
I'm encouraging all of my relatives, all of my Native American relatives and friends to get out and vote. Vote as if your life depended on it, because your life is depending on it for your families, for your villages, for your clans, for your tribal nations. These are the most important elections that are coming up, and who we have, especially as our next president, as our next vice president. They're going to be making policy. They're going to be appointing particularly leaders that will oversee the Bureau of Land Management.
To the people, vote as if your life depended upon it, because it does. To the people who are elected, we have to understand how essential water is. Make it a human right. Stop all utility and water shutoffs during this crisis. This is not the time to be causing people to try to operate without water. And invest in the infrastructure in this nation that we need to allow everybody to have access to clean, safe drinking water and water for all the other things that are essential for life.
Angela, Catherine, Governor Lewis, thank you for joining us today. Your commitment to making sure that the most vulnerable in America never have to go a day without water is truly an inspiration. Thank you. With that, I'd like to thank the members of the Value of Water campaign for enabling us to recognize the 6th annual Imagine a Day Without Water. And I'd like to thank the more than 1,000 organizations, from water utilities to mayors to companies to the press, social media, schools, for working together to build awareness around the stewardship of our life's most essential resource, water. And I want to thank all of you who have joined us for this event, and I invite you to continue to participate in the day's activities. You can learn more by visiting www.imagineadaywithoutwater.org. Thank you, and be healthy.
Aspirations and hopes are coming true. Believe in yourself, the rest is up to me. Yeah.